joining. I'm Julie Ann Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. One of the many things I'm extremely passionate about is the empowering of owners through education, resource, and expertise. It's why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I've asked Jason Turner with Great Lakes Advisors to join me. Jason is the Chief Investment Strategist of Great Lakes Advisors. He's a member of the firm's investment committee, authors market and economic commentary, regularly presents in the media and to professional conferences, and works with client portfolio managers to support institutional and private clients. As head of multi-asset strategy, he is responsible for portfolio strategy, asset allocation, and for overseeing the firm's manager due diligence and selection efforts. He is also a member of the firm's operating committee and management committee. Prior to joining Great Lakes in 2009, Jason served in the various roles of Skyline Asset Management and Aon Hewitt Investment Consulting. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Jason Turner. Welcome, Jason.
Thank you.
Great to have you here. I missed you down in Racine when you were at the 2021 Midwest Staffing Owners and Executive Retreat at the nice, beautiful Windspread Retreats in the Executive Center.
Yes, what a fantastic venue.
Isn't that beautiful? We were there recently as well for some meetings, but I heard you did a fabulous job. Everybody was very engaged and really was excited to hear your presentation. So I'm excited about our time together today because a lot's going on. So let's start right away with an update on the economic outlook as it stands today and what it's telling us about the current environment.
Sure. We've spent a lot of time talking about the economy and the state of markets. And the two questions I get asked the most are around inflation and unemployment. And those seem to be the headline items. We also talk about GDP growth, and we certainly have seen a year in 2021 of above trend GDP growth, something we'd expect during a recovery from the turmoil we experienced in 2020. Now, accompanying that growth has been above trend inflation. And this is obviously important because we're seeing both businesses and consumers dealing with price inflation. Some pretty extreme levels of price inflation, to be more accurate, levels we haven't seen in 40 years. And that's somewhat to be expected with the loose monetary environment we see right now, the extra fiscal stimulus that's been put to work over the last 2 years, and also just a recovery from an economic condition that was not quite rosy in 2020. Mm-hmm. So we've seen high levels of inflation. We've also seen unemployment come down precipitously from its high levels in 2020 to a mid-fours level here. And we're getting an update here at the end of this week on where we stand as of the end of December in terms of the unemployment level. But we're also still hearing from businesses that there is a lot of shortages in the job market, a lot of open positions. We had a peak during the fall of more than 11 million open positions, highest level we've ever seen. Mm-hmm. So there's certainly some challenges as we look forward. And in terms of an outlook, we would anticipate above trend growth in 2022, but lower than what we saw in 21. And we'd anticipate towards the middle of this year, inflation starting to ease a little bit, but likely to finish the year above 3%. And we're likely to see the Federal Reserve get off the dot and start raising interest rates, probably as early as March.
Okay. All right. So here comes the rates back up again. So all those that'll affect the homeowners as well, with everybody doing their refinancing their homes as well, I would anticipate, is correct?
Yes, definitely. We've definitely seen a slowing of the refinancing trend. We've obviously got a lot of people that jumped on that opportunity over the course of the prior 18 months, but as rates have even come up just from market movement and the Fed starting to taper its bond buying purchases, we started to see a slowdown in refinancing, but we haven't quite seen the slowdown in new home sales.
Mm-hmm. No.
Still a backlog there.
Very good. So you touched on unemployment, and one of the things that we've been hearing a lot of for what they referred to in 2021 was the Great Resignation, and it really contributed to the unemployment. It's hurting us right now because you said that we're at I believe nationally 4.2 for unemployment rates. And You know, the clients and staffing are seeing there's a lot of orders out there, but they cannot find the candidates. Lot of opportunity, nobody out there. What is contributing to this problem that we're seeing that we can't find the people?
Well, there are a couple of things. One, a shorter term trend and one, a longer term trend. Since the economic shutdowns of the spring and summer of 2020, we saw a number of people leave the workforce. You know, in that unemployment number, we only count people that are actively looking for work. You have to meet kind of three key criteria: that you're available to work and you're actively looking for work, and you've taken an actual action in the last 4 weeks to try to find a job. If you're not doing those things, you're out of the labor force. And we've seen a dramatic drop in the labor force participation rate. It started to come back a bit towards the latter half of 2020 and then leveled off and has stayed about at this level. We're roughly 3 million individuals short in terms of the labor force. And the labor force hasn't grown. We're also doing this in the middle of a headwind of a demographic shift where we're going to have a smaller labor force on a go forward. We're in those sort of peak baby boom retirement years. And as folks leave the workforce or decide to leave the workforce a little early, if they're in that baby boom generation, we have definitely seen that trend emerge in the last 18 months as well. If you're within a year of retiring, why look for another job? Why go back to the job you were anxious to get away from? You're just walking away. We've definitely seen that trend emerge. The longer dated trend that I mentioned is we've actually seen an increase in job openings that has been persistent for the 6 years prior to the pandemic that really exacerbated this labor force participation issue. We've seen an American economy that needs more labor, and the labor just hasn't been there to meet those trends, whether that's a demographic trend or whether that's a shift for the younger generations and the importance of work in their lives. And we've certainly seen that. And you mentioned the Great Resignation. The other piece there is the quits rate. And we haven't seen quits rates this high really in the time that the Department of Labor has been keeping that statistic. So, you know, we just did another record just announced this week for the prior month for November. So, we're definitely seeing quits increase, people just walking away from their jobs. And I would imagine we would see another round of that here in the first quarter as those jobs that get paid end of year bonuses or the like, they get those bonuses, bank them, and then likely that's the trigger. There was a stat I saw yesterday, a recent survey done by Fidelity that said that 4 in 10 American workers are anticipating switching jobs this year. Wow. That's a significantly high number. Yeah, you know, 40% is a very, very high number. Those surveys usually in the upper teens,
right,
at the highest. So you're looking at still another round of folks planning to quit their jobs at some point this year. So wow. Dealing with that headwind, a shortage in the labor force participation, and a longer term trend of the need for more labor to keep the economy growing at its current rate certainly contributes to a lot of what we're seeing right now in the employment market and the shortages businesses are feeling.
Are we still feeling the effects of COVID fears as well, and people taking on responsibilities to care for their either parents or family members or whatever that is also contributing to the shortage?
Definitely. Those folks that left the labor force, the myriad of reasons they left, the most popular, if you look in the mainstream media, has been, oh, it's those transfer payments, those extended unemployment and stimulus checks. Well, they also all went away in September.
Right.
And we've not seen labor force participation dramatically improve. And that's because that was never actually higher than fifth in surveys in terms of reasons. You mentioned a couple of the big ones. Number one, it's care. It's either taking care of the kids or taking care of the older generation. And we saw that same trend after 2008, 2009, when we saw a number of layoffs and people say, I'm just going to sit out of the labor force for a while and take care of my family. The other response that we saw creep into the survey responses that is surprising given the change in the last 60 or 70 years in the United States is my spouse works. Individuals saying, we're comfortable being a single earner household, which has not been the American trend for some 60 years. So yeah, that likely doesn't last, particularly with high levels of inflation. That same survey says that those folks are going to look for a job between 1 and 6 months. The vast majority of them will start looking again. So we're thinking that in the first half of this year, as inflation persists, as folks find it more and more difficult to make ends meet on a single income, that some of those labor force levers start coming back.
Okay.
And maybe that's not till the spring, but it should be a trend we start to see emerge at some point towards the middle of the year.
That's good news. That's really good news because, you know, we've been feeling it for quite some time. And it is something that is surprising that we're hearing is the single earners, the single wage earners that you haven't seen in the past for many years. And then the newer, the younger generation saying, you know, quality of life, we're going to go to having only one of the spouses work and stay home with the kids and, you know, manage our household income with one wage earner. That's a new perspective that we've not seen for many years. So, it's good to hear that you feel that they feel that we'll see that pendulum start to shift as inflation keeps on going up, because we need that. We do need more workers back in the economy. We need it. It's hurting us. Okay. Let's talk about, well, another contributor, I think, with this that we've seen, and we're hearing a lot on this, is wage growth as well. Right. We certainly felt it in 2021. And I'm wondering, where does this go? How far does that pendulum shift to the one side? I mean, I've heard different stories on this and read a lot of different articles on where does it stop? So can you talk about the wage growth and what's the current level of wage growth? And can we expect this to settle down at all in 2022?
Sure. As an economist, we talk a lot about equilibrium and different things, trying to find an equilibrium price, a comparison supply and demand. And wages and inflation are certainly one of those interrelated items. And we go back to the 1970s and you see a wage price spiral where you saw inflation perk up and wages responded. It overshot. So inflation perked back up again. And then we had actually three rounds of that spiral occur in the 70s. Now, different economic makeup. So this, to us from an economic perspective, the current environment looks a lot more like the post-World War II years than it does the 1970s. So that's one slight encouraging historical comparison. But there is that interrelationship between wages and inflation. And with inflation up, real wages adjusted for inflation, are actually still about 1.25% short in terms of their growth rate over the last 12 months compared to where inflation has gone. So there's still room for wages to go up from here. And as competitive as the labor market is, we mentioned there's those 3 million people out of the labor force. One of the easy enticements to get somebody off the I'm not participating and back into the participation of the labor force is pay more. Mm-hmm. We've definitely seen that, particularly in the hospitality and restaurant sectors, where wage growth is significantly higher. And all of a sudden, it seems mm-hmm. like everybody jumped to a $15 an hour rate for those folks that were much, much lower before right. the pandemic started. So we're starting to see more wage pressure up in pockets. We're likely to see that spread out here a little bit in 2022. So it mm-hmm. becomes more and more of the condition across industries. There's probably in most industries a little bit more room to go up from a wage perspective, either from competition or from wages still falling short of inflation. And that's going to be a reality for businesses. I think it's a reality to kind of reset your mindset that employment costs, labor costs are going to be a little bit higher in 2022 than probably what you anticipated when you made your three-year plan back in 2019.
Okay. So what you're saying is we're behind the eight ball. We should have had wage increases over the last several years, and we really held that down. And so now we're paying the piper. We're paying the price for it.
To an extent, we can broaden that up to include inflation in that explanation too. The Fed has targeted 2% core inflation since the 2008-09 crisis, and they've failed to hit it in any of those 13 years. So all of a sudden, we're now well above it. If we expand mm-hmm. that inflationary look out to 10 years, we're only just now getting to average levels of inflation that they had targeted over the last decade. Well, wages, because they're so tightly linked to inflation, also kind of undershot where you'd normally see wage growth. If we said inflation is normally 2-3%, if we look at the last 40 years or so, wages should be in that 4-4.5% range. Wages always outpace inflation by a little bit. And over the last year, they've undershot inflation. So they've got some more room to get in front of inflation and maybe a little bit more room beyond that to say competitive environment, wages should be a little bit higher.
Interesting. Well, that's going to be a hard one for people to handle, to take.
It's a hard pill to swallow. It is mm-hmm. for a business owner.
Our budgets are all going to take a major hit with that. So you mentioned earlier, you believe the Fed's we're going to see at least 2-3 interest hikes in 2022. Where does it go from here? Is it stop at in 2022 with three hits or no?
So if we look at the Fed's dot plot, and then we can trust this about as far as I can throw collectively all the Fed governors, but we're looking at three this year, three next year, in 23, and then maybe one additional in 24. Realistically, it seems like the market is pricing in a believability to the 2022 increases, and then a lot of skepticism beyond 2022. Okay. I think there's a lot to be seen. You know, we've been here in terms of low rates for 10 or 12 years, but it's still a relatively new experience in the pantheon of central bank activity. We've certainly seen Europe fail to get off the negative rate dot since 2008. So as we persist on this kind of cheap money, low rate environment, what does it mean to see rates go up 150 basis points over the course of 2 years from here when they're sitting at 150 basis points on the 10-year to start with?
Right.
That's sort of unknown territory. And I think its implications for growth, and if we go into the out years, growth starts to slow back towards our long-term average. And that average has really come down to the 2-2.5% range. So if we're pushing rates into the 1.5, 1.75, 2% range towards the end of 23, beginning of 24, and you're saying that's going to be the long-term growth rate, that becomes a weirdly non-sustainable level of interest rates. As strange as that sounds to say 2%, inflation is tough to sustain. If you're only growing at 2%, it might be. And yeah, that's something we just have to wait and see. So 2022, I think we're two increases almost definitely, three increases pretty certainly, provided we don't get derailed in terms of economic growth here in the first half of the year. Beyond that, it's very, very tough to call.
Okay. Okay, the spike, the recent spike in COVID, what does that do to the economy? Does that have any major impact? I mean, we're hitting all-time highs this week, as you know, in the United States. Do we see shutdowns completely like we did back a year ago, when, you know, Chicago completely shut down, New York shut down? Or do we, are we into just handling like we've been handling it, and it doesn't impact the economy as bad as it did a year ago?
Well, we've really been through three prior spikes, and this is our fourth significant spike in terms of increase in case rates. One of the things I think the economy has learned as we've gone through this is how to deal with this in stride, that more restrictions on the margins help. Slow the spread from a healthcare perspective, and number of ICU beds, hospital beds available, things like that are more the critical factor than it is total caseload. But we use the Delta variant as an example, most recent example. That was our spike from August into September of last year. And we did not see the same economic impact, obviously, that we saw during the first or second spike from Delta. That was mitigated. Now, we were expecting 5 or 6% growth in the third quarter, and we got 2. So it did slow consumer activity a little bit. Mm-hmm. I think what we're seeing here with the spike related to the Omicron variant is number one, it's occurred in what is typically a lull in the retail sales calendar anyway. We're in that post-holiday period where holiday shopping should have been booked before we started to see these case increases. Mm-hmm. So from an economic growth perspective, since we're a consumer-driven economy, that might help us hold on to better gains in the next round of data. We'll get the fourth quarter GDP result will be the next result we see. And that should show relatively robust growth. Where we get some concern is here in the first quarter of 2022. And we won't see those numbers until well into the spring. But the things I would watch closely, the weekly jobless claims, for example, out of the last 4 weeks, three of them have been below 200,000. That is a historically low level. We're in the mid 200,000s in a normal, regular weekly cadence in 2019. So those being lower than what we saw during Delta and what we saw during the second wave in the prior winter, that tells us that some of those sectors that have been laying off employees preemptively because they anticipated a slowdown aren't. Right. They're not changing staffing. If they're not changing staffing, that's telling us that the consumers are still there, the people are still there placing orders, that there's still a backlog in terms of the manufacturing sector. Those backlogs are actually getting a little better because we're actually seeing some inventory restocking, which is a great recent statistic from the Chicago PMI for December. So we're definitely seeing some more robust signs of economic activity this time around. So the base case, and we're probably still early to make this kind of call, but the base case with this spike is it's likely not as impactful as what we saw with the impact of the Delta variant in the August, September timeframe. And that's good news.
Okay, that is good news. That's great. For the staffing owners who are out there and they're in various different sectors servicing, you know, we talk to them, we coach them on the receivables because that's really where their risk is at. And for most part, you know, we've got a large uptick in healthcare staffing, which we feel very comfortable with. Actually, those receivables are turning better because they need those healthcare workers. So I think the hospitals are paying better and the VMSs are paying better and the IT is doing well. Some of the concerns that we're seeing are areas that we're concerned with and you and I have talked about is in the distribution centers, is where we're staffing distribution centers to move product through in that, especially with textiles or just distribution itself. Anything you can tell our listeners that you would watch out for, be concerned with?
Well, I mentioned backlogs, supply chain issues, and inventory restocking. So those are all themes that really impact those distribution centers. The other is we saw during this pandemic period an acceleration of a number of trends that were building for a decade or so before. And one of those trends was the transition to online retail instead of bricks and mortar. Mm-hmm. That is a different distribution of distribution centers than what you'd have to support brick and mortar buildings.
Right.
And that trend was accelerating. So with that trend accelerating, there's a greater need for distribution in that context. Mm-hmm. We also have seen a shift in the Chicago PMI numbers that I referenced earlier that we got for December are important. And we hopefully will see them reiterated in the broad national ISM numbers here in a couple weeks for December. But it appears that businesses that had been running low on stock, had been saying supply chain, took the advantage of orders or staffing being higher, orders being a little bit lower, and started building inventory back to try to get ahead of supply chain issues. That's a good thing from a distribution perspective too, because it takes this trend we've seen short term in distribution staffing need and pushes it further out into the year to say, yes, there will be an inventory restocking trend for a lot of businesses to say, we want to maintain a little bit higher inventory because we've seen demand be higher. As we get lulls, we want to stock up so that we can meet a demand surge if and when we get one.
But do we get concerned about brick and mortar businesses because of the fact that the trend is not to go to the brick and mortar to do more online? I mean, everybody, I didn't go any Christmas shopping at any stores this year at all, a single store, which is unusual.
Yeah, the number of broken down cardboard boxes out at my curb weekly for garbage pickup has been significant.
Yes.
Over the last month or so. I certainly feel that. And that's true. This trend of online over brick and mortar was accelerated through the pandemic. A lot of people got very, very comfortable with the idea that I can just go online, get what I need, have it delivered to my door in 2 days, and I'm fine with that. I don't need to run out this afternoon and buy it. That pushes us away from brick and mortar. You see a lot of brick and mortar stores evolve into curbside delivery to say, yes, we can deliver, and almost turning those brick and mortar stores into last mile distribution centers where you can go park out front, they'll bring your order to your car, or they can deliver from the store to you. So that last mile, that easy delivery, whether you're using a service that does that shopping for you or the store is providing that service to you, it in effect is an extension of the distribution center. And that evolutionary concept, we'll see over the course of the next couple of years how that helps maintain some permanence for some of those brick and mortar footprints.
We'll have to just watch it. Yep. What is the media not talking about that is really important for us to know?
Oh, that's a loaded question.
A loaded question.
Well, with all of the focus being on inflation and focus on gas prices and the change of price in food and things like that, two things really stick out to me. One, we've had above trend inflation in a number of different areas, and it's been persistent for 20 years, and that's healthcare and education. Mm-hmm. And those have not slowed down. Those have kept up a very, very high rate of inflation. If you look at a retiree who 20 years ago was planning on their healthcare expenditures, it's more than doubled in terms of what their actual expenditure is going to be now versus 20 years ago when they were planning. So there are levels of inflation, and here's the undercurrent that's not being reported. There's levels of inflation that are going to be persistent. They're going to stay. and stick with this, and we're going to have to get used to higher prices in some regard. The Fed's kind of realized that and kind of pulled that idea of transitory back out of the lexicon, but to say inflation was ever transitory was a little bit crazy. The other one is the impact of politics in most of the questions we're talking about here. And from my perspective and my expertise is really that intersection between economies and the equity and fixed income markets. Markets like it when there's paralysis in Washington because Washington just kind of stays out of their business. And you see the results we had in the stock market last year. Some of that is because there wasn't anything to upset the apple cart. There was no major tax change by the end of the year. There was no major disruption. There was a need in infrastructure bill, but it was right down the middle of critical need in infrastructure. As we move into a midterm election year and we move later in the year, I think you're going to see a little bit more impact from the political environment, and whether that's polarization and the inability of two sides to really ever reach some sort of compromise agreement or anything, or potentially a shift in the makeup of the House or Senate, those are going to start to weigh on markets and potentially even weigh into the economy towards the end of the year. So that's something that is not getting a lot of press now. It will, I think, during the middle point of the year. And as regulations change or potentially change, I think it's going to be very, very important for business owners to keep a close eye on what might change in that either tax or legal environment for them.
Wow. That's good luck with what we see in those results of those elections mid-year. So is there anything else that we haven't discussed that could influence the direction of the economic world in 2020 and beyond?
Well, we touched on COVID. I think the big risks right now are more bolt from the blue type. You get a mutation in the COVID that sends it into something that's more serious, and we do have to implement more lockdowns. I think the base assumption of, hey, we're going to keep growing, inflation's going to mitigate, and unemployment is going to resolve itself, the supply chain is going to resolve itself, it's a complacent viewpoint. And getting too complacent in those viewpoints by the middle of the year is going to be challenging. I think we're going to see a volatile year. I think from a market perspective, from an economic perspective, you're going to see good months and bad months. You're going to see some waves here and there. We've gone well overdue for a 10% market correction. At some point, we'll likely see that, either driven by economic data or just simply by valuations in the stock market. But from an economic perspective, it's going to be less of a smooth ride and a little bit more of a roller coaster, I think, as we go forward. There'll be months where we'll get surprising unemployment numbers that we backed up a little bit, or that we saw a spike in inflation in an unexpected way.
Mm-hmm. Are you expecting any more additional help from the government like we had with PPP or employee retention credit, those dollars that went out so fast to help businesses?
I think the experience with those programs, and you mentioned two very, very good ones, the experience of those programs that helping businesses from a government perspective has better economic impact than just sending a stimulus check to individuals.
Right.
If we look at stimulus check to individuals, the first stimulus checks, our savings rate go from 7% to 33% nationally. People put it in the bank.
Mm-hmm.
You don't see that money deployed. PPP loan program, businesses stayed open. Businesses were well capitalized. They were able to see through the short-term disruption, shortest recession we've had in really the post-war period, and come out the other side with the forgiveness portion of the PPP program, not in worse shape than you would expect having gone through a rapid and quick recession. So those type of programs should be front of mind for politicians. Yeah, given the economic environment we see right now, I don't see a huge likelihood we'll see any of those in the first half of the year, unless you see some sort of backup in terms of the economic landscape. In that case, I think those are easy programs to put into place.
Okay, great. All right. Anything else? This has been interesting.
I appreciate the opportunity to have the chat today.
Well, it's always great. It's one of my favorite things these days is always listen to an economist. I always like talking to him and hearing what you have to say. It's one of the first conferences when every time I go to a conference, it's the first one I go to is who's the speaker on the economy so I can go listen to him. But thank you for your time. Your insight is always enjoyable and very informative. So I appreciate it. it's good to see you as always. And hopefully we'll see you again in 2022. We can get another read, maybe mid-year. We can see after the election and see what has happened with the election and see what your prediction is after that. How's that?
Yeah, that would be great.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Jason. I appreciate it.
Thank you.